Living Seed Media brings to you God's Word, which is His comprehensive equipment for changing lives. May the Lord impact your heart as you encounter His Word. For further inquiry or counsel, contact Peace House, P.O. Box 971, Boko, Benue State, Nigeria. Telephone numbers 0703-036-3659, 0703-768-1198. Email address lsmedia@livingseed.org or visit our website at www.livingseed.org. Let us sit back and listen as the servant of God brings forth the word of life.
For the message tonight, we want to consider the minister's passion for preaching Christ. The minister's passion for preaching Christ. I want us to quickly go to Matthew chapter 9, the gospel according to St. Matthew chapter 9, and we read from verse 35 through 38. Matthew 9:35. And Jesus went about all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues and preaching the gospel of the kingdom and healing every sickness and every disease among the people. But when he saw the multitude, he was moved with compassion on them because they fainted and were scattered abroad as sheep having no shepherd. Then said he unto the disciple, the harvest truly is plenteous, but the laborers are few. Pray ye therefore the Lord of the harvest, that he will send forth laborers into his harvest. Again, before we continue, we will quickly also read John 9 verse 4. I must work the works of him that sent me while it is day. The night cometh when no man can walk. In these passages, we have seen our master, his commitment to the work God has committed into his hand. He said that he must do the work that the Father has asked him to do. He has a business before which he has come to do in the world. And in Matthew 9, we read that when he was going, he saw the multitude and he had compassion with them. Which kind of compassion? Because they all scattered around as sheep without shepherd. And that was why he prayed that the Lord will send harvester unto the field to harvest. And fortunately, God has seen in us harvesters that he has enlisted into the field of harvest. We minister, God has directly or indirectly enlisted us into his work that we may lend a helping hand on the field to harvest. The question is, we as ministers, why has God called us? Why has he made us minister to minister to his people? And when we consider that the minister's passion for preaching Christ Passion means strong feelings. Minister with strong feelings to introduce Christ to the people. In fact, when we look at our vocation, the commitment in our vocation is to preach Christ to people. In when we consider Proverbs 24, verse 18, it says, where there is no vision, the people perish. A minister that does not know the purpose why God has called him into the ministry will only be on his own doing what he likes. But I believe that all of us here, we said that we had a calling before we come into the ministry. It is our calling that has brought us into the ministry, because many of us, we are pursuing one vocation or the other before we decided to come into the ministry. If we said that we receive calling from God for this work, why then has God called you? And to do what? That is the major problem that we have. Many of us that we say we receive call from God, we could not identify or really define the purpose why God has brought us into the ministry. It's just like when you are in your secular job as a teacher, why are you brought to teach? And for what purpose? Maybe your discipline is mathematics. It is because of mathematics that you are employed. And your primary assignment in that school is to teach mathematics. If you say you have a calling to the ministerial work, then the question is, what is your primary assignment in coming into the ministry? Your coming into the ministry is to minister salvation unto people that you are pastoring. If you do anything outside that, you are a failure. And God has made open to us areas that we can minister his salvation unto people. Most especially, we are very fortunate in the ministry, because there are a lot of platforms made available for us to reveal Christ to our congregation. When we talk of marriage, we bring people unto you so that you can release unto them, you can make known to them Christ. If it is burial, you have opportunity to minister Christ. If it is the normal worship every Sunday, or even in prayer meetings, you have opportunity to reveal Christ to everybody. We look into the life of Isaiah. Isaiah was a good preacher, and he prophesied and condemned the sins of the people. But he got to a point in chapter 6 of Isaiah, the Lord revealed to him a vision, and in that vision he was able to discover God. And he was able to discover himself, and he was able to discover his environment. And that is why the word in verse 5 says, "Who?" Because he saw God and saw himself, and he could see that God is so holy, and that even though he has been preaching the word, but with soiled mouth, he saw himself as a sinner. And not that alone, he looked inwardly and saw himself that he has been with dirty mouth, he has been ministering to the people. And not that alone, he saw people around him as living in the midst of sinners. Until all of us are able to see this vision, we see God in his glory. We see ourselves that we are in need and that we are not capable, but God has made us capable by adoption when we are converted. And he placed a work, an assignment in our hands to go out and minister his word and reveal himself unto people. And in the vision he saw multitude and saw them as sinners. The same thing happened to Joel. When God gave him a prophecy concerning the children of Israel, he said, multitude in the valley of decision, for the day of the Lord is near in the valley of decision. And the sun and the moon shall be darkened, and the star shall withdraw their shining. The Lord also shall roar out of Zion and utter his voice from Jerusalem, and the heaven and the hope and the earth shall shake, but the Lord will be the hope of his people and the strength of the children of Israel. When we look around and we are able to perceive and see properly the people around us, where they are heading to, you as a person that's supposed to help them, we need to come to rescue them. Multitudes in our society today are perishing. Many of them are wallowing in sin that will lead to destruction, because the word of God says that the wages of sin is death. Is death. If we have passion for them and we don't want them to die suddenly in hellfire, there is need for us as a rescuer to rescue people from perishing. Majority of our members that we are pastoring, you know in yourself that majority of them do not have the grip of Christ. Many of us, we pamper them, we tell them sweet things that we make them to be committed to the church, not to be committed to God. We find it difficult to strike what sin is. And in every way, even though we organize many programs, most, for example, like it was said the other time, that many of us, we organize prayer meetings, which will even last 7 days, 14 days, but throughout the program of the prayer meetings, all what we will center our attention on is how to destroy our enemies. How to destroy our enemy. There will be no time that we will expose these people to see their inward life, whereby they can turn to Christ. If we don't capitalize on destroying of one's enemy or one's destiny, then we go into seven step of prosperity. And that is what we will hammering on throughout the 7 days. But we know that the word of God says that we should tell sinners that it will not be well with him. We will never mention that area. But we look for passages in the Bible that we speak to their consciousness or to their conscience that if you do this, if you do that, you will make a breakthrough. But we will never at any time bring them to Psalm 1. And starting from verse 1, that says, blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly. That area we will not expose to them. That only those people that can have a breakthrough and can be blessed are those people that are not walking in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standing in the way of sinners, nor seated in the seat of the scornful. We will not explain that area to them. But what we will explain to them is how David made it, how Solomon became prosperous, and how this and that. But the brain behind their prosperity we will not reveal. And this is because we have no passion, we have no strong feeling for where these people will end their life at the end of the day. Majority of our members that we have and we are responsible to do not know the true gospel of God. They do not know the grace that is in the gospel, because we, the minister, have no vision than to get our daily bread. Many of us, we gather people because we want to make money, we want to pay our assessment. In fact, most of the time, it is our assessment that is our focus, not even the soul. And when you see people visiting, making visitation, it's not because they want their souls, but because they want them to come to the church so that the offering in the church will be better. And when we hear that somebody is there, we will be eager for the burial, because we know that at least that will bring income. We don't have pity where that person is going to spend eternity. And all these things matter so much before God. Jesus knew why he came to the world. But many of us, we don't know why we have come into the ministry. In Luke chapter 4, verses 18 and 19, Jesus declared that the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to preach deliverance to the captive, and recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty them that are bruised, and to preach the acceptable years of the Lord. He got it correctly right from the onset. The question is, do we get it correctly before we enter into ordination? And after we have entered into ordination, what is our motive? What is our objective? Why have we come into the ministry? To do what? And since we have been in the ministry, what have we achieved? Many of us, we take pride in the auditorium that we build. We take pride in the vicarage we build. We take pride in the bus. We call it evangelism bus. But do we actually use that bus for evangelism? But when it comes to souls, how many souls have you won since you have been in the ministry? You will scarcely see us counting one or two. Many of us will be in a parish for 5 years. And if they ask us, within these past 5 years, how many souls have you won for the Lord? You will scarcely see us pointing to one that we have won and we have discipled. All these are pointer of failure. Many of us have become managers. We are maintaining officers. We maintain what we meet on ground. In fact, in the course of maintaining what we met on ground, most of the parishioners will leave the church, because when they find out that they are not getting enough nourishment from us, they leave the church. But Jesus said, I must walk the works of him that sent me while it is day. The night cometh when no man can walk. That is Jesus, whose image we must conform to. This is Jesus, the ultimate, that is laying foundation for us. And is the same man that has employed us as minister to minister life unto people. He was so passionate about people. He was so zealous. He has the dream. He has the vision that he must walk the walk of the Father while it is yet day, because the night cometh when no man can walk. How serious do we take the ministry God has committed into our hands? And he said unto them, how is it that ye sought me That was to the parents, even as early as 12 years. When the parents were looking for him, he told them, "Why are you seeking for me? Will you not know that I must be about my father's business?" What is the business? What is your business in this ministry? All what we are rushing for is how to become big. Big for nothing. And the real work that God has committed into our hands, we have left it undone. But facing shadows, how to make it. Many of us, we have abandoned the real work, but we want to be like others. We look at our colleagues that we were both in university together and take to secular job, and we were in the hands of God. And we see within 2 years, 3 years, they bought good cars, they have built mansions, and we say, wow, after all, we left university together. Why me? Why this? Why that? And because of that, we will look for a way of cutting corners too, to make ourselves comfortable. Is that the work God has placed in your hands? We look for ways of helping ourselves. But Jesus said unto them, "My meat is to do the will of him that sent me and to finish his work." Are you, after doing the will of God that has ordained you into the ministry, like Brother Gwile said yesterday, we need to consider our calling from where God brought us. We that were no people, but God has made us something in his hand for the world. I imagine no matter your age, if the president of the nation will come to your church for prayer, despite the fact that he's a president, and maybe you don't have more than a diploma of theology, this man will still come before the altar, kneel down, and you place your hands on him. The professor will come and kneel down before you, and you put your hands on him. I don't see any honor that is greater than that. Man of God. They call us man of God. But are we really portraying the picture that people pictured us? Are we really man of God? Are we really doing the will of the master that has brought us into the ministry? The word of God says in Matthew 28, "And he said unto them, Go ye unto all the world and preach the gospel to every creature." In Matthew, he said, "Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world." One thing that always pushed me is that at times, whenever I take my wife to market in those days, and she enters the market and I'm in the car, I will see multitude of people going up, coming down, going up, looking for what to buy. And the Spirit of God will tell me, "These people, are you sure that they are going into heaven?" Multitude in the valleys of decisions. And that will prick my heart. On Saturday or Friday or Sunday, open your television. Those of us that we love football, see multitude in the stadium. Are your spirit not pricked and say, these people that are sitting here, where are they heading to? Thousands of them in the stadium, watching football. How many of them will make heaven? Are you not being touched? And see many people that are streaming to heaven, to hell. And no wonder Jesus said that the road that leads to hell is very wide. Very, very wide. At least to heaven, very narrow, only few. Why can't we be one of those people that will be instructing and leading people towards this narrow road? But we feel comfortable in our vicarages, getting ourselves relaxed. The word goes out into the open to market their products. And they have strategies that they use to market their products for people to buy. They picture it, they do everything in order to make the product very good. But the question is, what is the product of the ministers? What are we selling? What are we producing and selling to the people? And how do we sell it? What we sell to people is Christ being crucified and the hope of glory, the one that has salvation in his hand. How many times when we are celebrating life, which we call burial, how many times do we try to push Christ to them and let them see the uselessness of the world and let them know that this is the end? No matter either you are rich or you are poor, a time is coming when you'll be like this. How many times do we announce to the people to come and accept Christ? What are we doing in pushing evangelism onto the people? It is vision that leads to passion. If you don't have vision and you don't know exactly what God has asked you to do, there's no way you will develop passion for it. And it is passion that develops body. It is the body in your heart that will push you moving to do even what you think you cannot do. Are you burdened as regards the religious situation and our outlook in our cities, in our towns, in our villages, and in Nigeria as a whole? The professing church of nowadays are becoming lukewarm and apostate. Many is fast becoming what you cannot imagine that will happen in the house of God. Many started well, but now they are now turning away from the faith. Just because it may be because of the economic situation, it may be because we lack vision, we don't know exactly what to do. Thousands of our regular churchgoers, we don't know, many of them do not hear the true gospel. Rather than we brainwash them, we give them what they want, not what God wants us to give them. Is it not yet time that true servant of God cry aloud and proclaim once again the mighty, soul transforming truth of the Bible? People are expecting something reasonable from us. If we compare the evangelistic labor of the apostles, the reformers of the old, and many of the esteemed men who were used in evangelism, such as Boyer, Whitefield, Edward, Spurgeon, Wesley, Finney, Moody, and Oswald Smith, if we compare their zealousness and their passion for evangelism with the present day ministers, you will cry. You will mourn. Because there are those people that were earlier than this, even in Nigeria, in those days, in the 70s, if you compare the evangelism of 70s with the present day evangelism, you will see a wide gap. Because in those days, Once you say you are a child of God, your mind will be, oh Lord, give me souls. Give me souls. And you move from one village to another, from one program to another. You plan strategies of winning souls. But today, everybody is minding his own business. Even pastors. How many times or what time, when you cast your mind back, when last have you taken your members for evangelism? When last have you called your members and said, let us go and fish? Rather, we do inside program, and when many of us are conducting a revival, we look at the gain at the end. Not the gain of souls, but the money that we collect during collections. Because we are really after how we pay our assessment. All these are watering down the work of evangelism in our various places. Anyone who will make an honest comparison will soon see a vast difference in the message in many areas, but particularly in respect of the character of God and the biblical doctrines in terms of evangelism. Have the glorious days of evangelism passed and passed forever? Where are men of strong passion for souls like we have in the days of Wesley? Is it really true that the day of revival are over in Nigeria in our churches? How do we handle all this? Evangelism is God's only method of getting his work done here on earth. Evangelism is the only method God is using to get his work done here on earth. It depends on us to actualize this in our generation. It is only through this that the fire of evangelism will be kept burning. The world is lost in sin. We can't doubt that. Even in the church, since sin are now dominating church, even right from the altar to the pews, we can't deny that. Man needs to be delivered from the clutches of Satan and from spiritual blindness, so as to come back to the Creator. So winning is not a pious extra or Sunday supplement. It is our central vocation, the highest duty and greatest privilege given to ministers, to minister life unto others. The Great Commission must be central in our thinking and action. It is not enough to pray and send. Christ commanded, go. So winning is life's most urgent endeavor that many of us we take lightly. We concentrate on things that are nothing before God. We centralize ourselves on things that will not make people to enter into heaven. But the only thing that is needful, we push it aside. Many of our members are living in total darkness of the true gospel. We have very few pulpits where genuine gospel is preached today. We have, at times, some of us will turn our people to politics. We turn it to theater, to dramatize. We turn it into a place where we canvass for money. We turn it to many things, whereas our pulpit is a place where people with high expectation are waiting for the true word of God that will reform their life. But what do we see? We have made it another thing. May the Lord raise up men in this meeting that will be mindful of the purpose why God has made them minister. Men who realizing the awful seriousness and responsibility of their calling, and laying aside all minor subjects, and fearlessly proclaim the great fundamental of the gospel that will lead to unmistakable repentance and testimony of the people. In this present generation, the enemy of the gospel, even among us, is upon us. Nothing but preaching of the gospel in the power of the Holy Spirit can stem the tide. Then let us evangelize. Let us go where the people are, and with the true gospel messages, and win the Christless masses to our Savior. Let us put gospel tracts and booklets in every home in our community. Scarcely will you see people as it was in those days distributing tracts today. Scarcely will you see it. But it's a good tool in our hands to witness in Christ. If you have passion for souls, you will look for every device to win souls to Christ. Like I said, God has made open to us a lot of available opportunities. For example, let me tell you something. On my own, it is always common and more or less tradition for some of us that we are bishops, that even though we may not have celebrated bad day before, but once we become bishop, we try to celebrate bad day every day, every year. You know why? And we also celebrate our consecration anniversary. And you know why? I look at all this. I say, these are good platforms that people can use to bring Christ to the people. In my own case, I'm so fortunate. Fortunate in the sense that I shared the month of my birthday is the same thing as the month of my consecration. And fortunately, they are so near. Instead of celebrating with glamour, I now turn it into harvest of souls. From 1st of March to 8th of March, everybody in the diocese, they will go out to harvest souls. And I have seen it working, because what can we present to God? I want to be grateful to God. The only thing that I can use to be grateful to God is souls. It's God that has elevated me to where I am now. What can I render unto Him? Not only with praises, but to present to Him souls that God has given us through this privilege and opportunity. And I have seen it really working in our diocese. Many, many churches have been planted as a result of this every year, declaring March 1 to March 8 as a period of soul harvesting. And I thank God for my clergy, my minister. They caught the vision, and they cooperate with us, and they are doing it as real period, apart from the other days, but that singular period. And I always tell them that when you do this, you are only celebrating with me, and you are celebrating the vision God has given me. Brothers and sisters, we have many avenues through which we can harvest soul for the Lord. Everything depends on the passion, the feelings you have for perishing souls. In the present generation, did you ever read Proverbs 24, verses 11 and 12? It says, if thou forbear to deliver them that are drawn unto death, and those that are ready to be slain, if thou said, behold, we know it not, does not that pondereth the heart consider it? And he that keepeth thy soul, doth not he know it? And shall not he render to every man according to his work? If men are threatened with death, and that is the second death, hell, fire, we fail to warn them, we are to be blamed. As ministers, we cannot plead ignorance. We can't say we do not know such an excuse will not be accepted. Ezekiel chapter 3, verse 17 through 19 says, Son of man, I have made thee a watchman unto the house of Israel. Therefore hear the word at my mouth, and give them warning from me. When I say unto the wicked, Thou shalt surely die, and thou givest him not warning, nor speaketh to him the wicked from warning to the wicked from his wicked way, this to save his life. The same wicked man shall die in his iniquity, but his blood will I require of thy at thy hand. Yet if thou warn the wicked, and he turn not from his wickedness, nor from his wicked way, he shall die in his iniquity, but thou hast delivered thy soul. Have we not read it? You are a minister over 400 people, and you refuse to warn them that the soul that sinners shall die, and the wages of sin is death. But you are pampering them. You don't want to offend them. And anytime any one of them dies, you are happy because you, most especially if you know that that old man has a lot of big children, you'll be happy. You say, yes, it is time for me to harvest money. But this old man or old woman has no eternity than to go to hell. The word of God says that I will require the blood of that person in your hands. Let us cast our mind back. How many burials have we conducted in our various churches? And consider each one of them. Where will they end their eternity? Is it in heaven or in hell? And these are dying in our hands. These people are dying in our hands. Do you think that you will not give an account at the end of the day? But you feel comfortable. You have no passion for their souls where they are going to spend eternity. He says, when I say to the wicked that he will die in his wickedness, in his wicked way, and you refuse to tell them, he says, their blood it will require from us. We must sound the alarm. We must tell them of their dangers. Paul is telling us in 1 Corinthians 9:16b, for necessity is laid on you as minister. Yea, who is unto you if you preach not the gospel? It matters not how spiritual a church may be, or how a minister of God may profess to be. If souls are not saved, something is practically wrong, and the professed spirituality is simply a false experience. If you say you are spiritual and you can't win a soul, then we will ask from you, where is the elements of your spirituality? Your experience is a deceit. People are satisfied to meet together. People are satisfied to meet together simply to have good time together in fellowship. They say, how is the fellowship today? You say it's wonderful. We gather together every now and then for prayer meeting. We do this, we do that. I remember there was a time in the church we were having prayer meeting. Because every prayer meeting, I normally go into the scriptures and tell them the rudimentary of what we mean by prayer and how their prayer can be answered. There was a woman that I didn't know. She was not my member. She was just passing by But not knowing that the woman was going to a place to commit suicide. And according to her testimony at the end of the day, when she was passing by, he said, one spirit just said, go into that church and listen to what is going on there. Lo and behold, she came, and I didn't recognize her. The word that she was hearing from my mouth was more or less as if, according to her, they opened the secret of her life for me. Right there, she gave her life to Christ. Right there, because for the past 2 weeks, she had never slept and neither eat anything. After that service, she became relieved, giving thanks to God. But she didn't tell me. She went back home, ate, and slept off. It was later that she came and said, thank God that I attended the prayer meeting. Now, all these avenues are avenues for us to minister Christ to the life of people. And for you to do it diligently, it depends on the passion you have for the people you are pastoring. If that passion is not there, you won't be able to achieve. The only thing that we need to do is to go to God in prayer and ask God and pray to God to give us passion for soul. To be relevant in this business, we must be spiritual, we must be spirit-filled, and be victorious over sin. Be 100% for Him. Your loyalty must not be divided. Your eyes must be focused on the Lord, and your intention, your mind will be to please God and please Him alone. And you must look for every avenue to please God and to fulfill the purpose why He has ordained you. It is only when you do this that you will be diligent, and there is no way every now and then there will be a test in your heart as if you have not satisfied the purpose why God has called you. You must fully yield yourself and entirely to God's work and be separated from the world and His affection. A movement, we need a movement that will be on fire for souls in our generation. As ministers, we must be endued with the power of the Holy Spirit, which will generate in us strong passion for soul, because fire begets fire. Our God is a consuming fire. God and fire are inseparable. So are men and fire. Every single one of us is now treading in a path of fire, either we like it or not. Not you alone, even your congregation, because there is hellfire for sinners and there is judgment fire for believers. All what we do here will be tried one day. The same thing with the sinners. Because the church has lost its Holy Ghost fire, millions go to hellfire. Every year we celebrate Pentecost. I will ask from you, what does Pentecost mean to you? We know that the church of God started on the day of Pentecost. But beyond that, did you see what happened during the day of Pentecost? When the disciples received power and Peter stood in the midst of people and ministered, 3,000 people were converted at a go. Pentecost means pain. Yet, we have so much pleasure. We see people around us perishing, but we are less concerned. Rather, we only make their money to live comfortably. We do not care for their souls. Pentecost meant burden, yet we love ease. The Pentecost we celebrate every year is just ordinary celebration. We may plan programs that we make every area look attractive. We decorate our church with all this decoration. And at the end of the day, the people will say, oh, the Pentecost of this year is so glamorous. Very nice. But what do you make out of that Pentecost as it was in the beginning? Pentecost means prison. Yet most of us will do anything rather than for Christ's dear sake get into prison. Perhaps Pentecost relief will get many of us into jail. Can we consider the Pentecost and look at the meaning so that with the Holy Ghost fire, it will generate passion that will make us have concern for the people or for our parishioners, the congregation that we pastor. Let us count the numbers of those people in our congregation and examine it critically. How many of them are we leading to heaven? That is where we ought to start. There must be a passion for soul in the heart of minister. He must be a prayer warrior who has body to travail. Who has body to travail for souls. Prayer makes the soul tender. Prayer creates hunger for souls. There's no way if you pray for anybody, you will want that person to live a correct life. And if you have thirst, you have passion for people, it will push you to your knee to pray for that person and to hand over the life of that person to the hands of God. It's only the understanding souls that will pray. The praying soul gets understanding. For this sin-hungry age, we need a prayer-hungry church. When you see the way things are going in your church, you need to gather people and cry unto God on behalf of others that God will save his people and deliver them. And that will push you to action. Let us arise from this meeting and evangelize our environment and keep doing it, that men may have a change to hear the gospel and be saved. Because how can they hear without somebody telling them? It's you that you need to tell them. The Bible says, how would they hear without being sent and without being informed? You are the one that God has sent out unto this generation to proclaim the gospel of salvation unto the lost. God will set his seal of approval on us as we do it for the salvation of the people, for the restoration of backslider, and the edification of believers. Quickly, before I come to the end, I want to challenge us with the word of an atheist, with the word of a communist, and with the word of a believer. An atheist gave this challenge. He says, if I firmly believe, as millions say they do, that the knowledge and practice of religion in this life influences destiny in another, then religion will mean to me everything. I will cast away earthly enjoyments as dross, earthly cares as follies, and earthly thoughts and feelings as vanity. Religion will be my first waking thought and my last image before sleep sank me into unconsciousness. I should labor in its cause alone. I will take thought for the morrow of eternity alone. I will esteem one soul gain for heaven. What a life of suffering. Earthly consequences will never stain my hands or seal my lips. Acts his joy and his grief will occupy no moment of my thought. I will strive to look upon eternity alone and on the immortal soul around me, soon to be everlastingly happy and everlastingly miserable. I will go forth to the world and preach to it in season and out of season. And my text will be, what shall it profit a man if he gains the whole world and lose his own soul? That is a word from an atheist that do not believe in God. And he said, if I should believe like other believers, those people that are religious, believe, then I will take this task of evangelism very seriously. I will develop strong passion. It will be my food. It will be my everything. I will sleep with it. I will wake up with it. I will be so passionate about souls that are around me that are getting lost. If an atheist can say that, what about you, minister of God, that God has ordained you principally for this work? How are you taking the work? A communist will say, we communists have high casualty rate. We are the one who yet shot and hung and lynched and are tied with jail and slander and ridicule and fire from our jobs and in every other way made as uncomfortable as possible. A certain percentage of us get killed and imprisoned. We live in virtual poverty. We turn back to the party every penny we make above what is absolutely necessary to keep us alive. That is a communist. In order to fulfill the ideology of communism, they sold their life totally. They prefer to work in abject poverty just to get the objective of communism attained or achieved. We communists don't have the time or the money for many movies and concerts or T-bone stick or decent homes or new cars. We have been described as fanatics. We are fanatics. Our lives are dominated by one great overshadowing factor, the struggle for world communism. What is your life being dominated of? Is it my life or I am saved to save others? Is your passion towards saving souls? It says, we communists have a philosophy of life which no amount of money could buy. This makes me to remember, you know, in our country we cry, we say they want to Islamize us. The Islam people, the Muslim, has agenda. The question is, what are the agendas of we Christians? What are the agendas that we are carrying? We are so lukewarm where we are. Our agenda is to make everybody Christian. But how are we pushing it? How are we pursuing it? These people are pursuing their own, and we are crying. Are they disturbing us not to pursue our own agenda? But we are lukewarm. We are lukewarm. We are so comfortable with coming, you know, with celebrating masses, with our communion services, with all these kind of services we have. We are so lukewarm. But these communist people, they said, we communists have a philosophy of life which no amount of money could buy. We have a cause to fight for and a definite purpose of life. What is the cause you are fighting for? We subordinate our petty personal services into a great movement of humanity. And if our personal life seems hard, or our egos appear movement of humanity, and if our personal life seems hard, and our eyes appear to suffer through subordination to the party, then we are adequately compensated by the thought that each of us, in a small way, is contributing something new and true and better for mankind. They are satisfied with that. Then the question is, what is your contribution to your generation for God? What is your contribution? These people are satisfied that they are contributing in their own way to humanity. There is one thing in which I am indeed earnest, and that is the communist cause. It is my life, my business, my religion, my hobby, my sweetheart, my wife, my mistress, my bread and meat. Remember, Jesus said, my meat is to do the work of whom has sent me. These people are now talking of meat, that communism is their meat. I work at it in the daytime and dream of it at night. I cannot carry on friendship. I cannot carry on a friendship, a love affair, or even a conversation without relating it to this force which both drives and guides my life. That is communism. And remember, we have a better thing in our hands. We have life. But these people do not have life. But they are well committed to things that will lead them to hellfire. But what will lead people to heaven, we are not committed. I evaluate people, I evaluate books and ideas and action according to how they affect the communist cause. And by their attitude towards it, I have already been in jail because of my ideas. And if necessary, I am ready to go before Fairness Court. That is a communist. But hear what John Wesley says. Give me 100 men who love God with all their hearts and fear nothing but sin, and I will move the world. Jesus says, say not ye, there are yet 4 months, and then cometh harvest. Behold, I say unto you, lift up your eyes and on the field, for they are white already to harvest. And lo, I hear the voice that says, whom shall I send, and who will go for us? Can you stand up to say, here am I, Lord, send me? Let us stand up. Let us stand up. How many years have you wasted in the ministry without having a soul to present to your Lord? How many times God has given you opportunity to minister the sincere word to the people and you shy away? Won't you say, here am I, send me, here am I, send me. If the Lord needs somebody, here am I, send me. Together, here am I, send me. Here am I, send me. If the Lord needs somebody, here am I, send me. The word has come. Who shall I send? And who shall go for us? Look on the field. The field is already white. Lift up your eyes, for the field is already white. who will go into the harvest field to harvest for the Lord. Pray to God and say, Lord, have mercy on me. Have mercy on me. If you die today, what will you present to your Maker? What will you say is your achievement in this ministry? What will you say is the labor and the fruit of your labor, or the fruit of your labor here on earth? Will you be able to present anybody and say, Lord, this is the fruits of my labor? Remember, the Bible says that any tree that does not bear fruit, any branch that does not bear fruit, shall be cut off. Do you want your life to be cut off? Won't you say, Lord, have mercy on me. Give me another opportunity. Make me what you want. Make me a good harvester in this place. And confirm it in my life before I leave this place. Like that man that was on his sick bed after he has been ministered to and gave his life to Christ. And he saw everything around him and saw people, souls perishing, even though on the sick bed. He rendered a chorus because he was so passionate about souls but had no opportunity of going out. And he sang a song. He said, shall I go an empty handed? Shall I meet my Savior's soul? Not with one soul to greet my Savior. Shall I empty handed go? Shall I go an empty handed? Shall I meet my Savior soul? Not with one soul to greet my Savior. Shall I empty handed go? Will you leave this world after all the opportunity God has given you to win soul? Will you leave this world without anything to show to your Master who has saved you so that you can save others? What will you say is your benefit for heaven? With all the resources God has given you, with all the privileges God has given you, taking you from nowhere and making you to die with the kings and princes, and at the end of the day, you become a failure in his hand. Won't you say, Lord, I don't want to be a failure. Have mercy on me. Lord, here am I. Send me. Lord, develop in me passion for soul, not passion for money. Passion for soul, not passion for prosperity. Passion for souls, not passion to accumulate. Create a deep gully of thirst. Test in me hunger in my soul. Multitudes are within our domain perishing. Many of us will say, our members will not come to church. Are they to come to church or for you to go and meet them where they are? Some of us will give excuses. It's because of economic crunch that we have in the nation. Because they will not have anything to, any offering to give. We make excuses for people why they do not come to church. But the word of God says, go. Go and preach the gospel to every nation, making disciples out of them. but we sit in our vicarage, we sit in our church, and we are expecting people to come. Pray that the spirit of lukewarmness towards the work of God, God will take this from you. Rebuke the spirit of lukewarmness in your life. I must not be barren. I must give birth. I must reproduce. Pray for forgiveness of the past lukewarmness. Pray for the forgiveness for the past uncared attitude. That the Lord will forgive you. Let us rededicate and recommit our lives unto God again. Are you not concerned for every soul that you lose in your church? You will hear the news, so person has passed on. Are you so much comfortable? Are you sure where they are going to spend eternity? Whereas God has made you a watchman over their lives. If a communist can be so committed to the cause of communism, and you, that you are having life, you are less concerned. Communists will struggle to make everybody be a communist. And at the end of the day, it will lead them to hell. But you, that the Lord has redeemed you for a purpose. The Lord has saved you to save others. You have no concern. After your salvation, you will care less whether others will be saved or not. You care less for others where they are going to spend their eternity. Is that not wickedness and selfishness? Pray that God will have mercy. Pray that the Lord will impart His Spirit on you. That what happened on the day of Pentecost will happen in your life. That the Holy Spirit will steer you unto action. Won't you see, Lord, all the wasted years that the cankerworm and palmerworm has eaten in my life, Lord, restore back unto me. That as from today, I will start having good days in witnessing your salvation unto others, in making you known unto people around me. That as from this present moment, I make up my mind. I will go into places, placing tracts, booklets into the hands of people to witnessing you unto souls, that souls may be brought back to the kingdom. Make passionate determination and enter into covenant with God and say, Lord, enough is enough. Henceforth, I don't want the blood of any of my parishioners to be requested from me. I want to be clear of their guilt. As we sing that chorus again, I call on Brother Pofi to come forward and pray for us. Yaraman, send me. Yaraman, send me. If the Lord will need somebody, Yaraman, send. Everybody, Yaraman, send me.
Yaraman, send me, Lord. If you need somebody, Yaraman, send me. Father, this is our heart cry tonight, that you will find each one of us people that you can send. Lord, we appreciate you so much because already where we are, we have a platform already that we can communicate your grace to your people, the people that you have entrusted in our care. Father, we plead with you that our pulpits will no more be barren. We ask, O God, that we will no longer abuse the pulpit, will no longer misuse the pulpit, that we'll use the pulpit as a platform to touch lives, to bring people into your saving grace. Ah, Baba, we ask, O God, that we will have fire in our own bones, fire in our own lives, so that fire from us will touch other people and kindle fire in their own lives. We ask that we will no longer be barren. We thank you for tonight. We thank you for challenging us. We plead with you that, Lord, we will have a clear passion. Lord, we will know why you save us. We'll know why you call us. And that, Lord, we will give in our all that others may come to know you. We thank you because you use others to save us, and you will use us also to save others. You will also use us to prepare people to also go out there and bring those that are not yet into the fold, to bring them in. We ask that, Lord, we will not trivialize this serious matter. Equip us. Our coming here is not in vain. Like our master, that, Lord, will have passion for lost souls. Thank you for the servant that you use. Renew him tonight. We ask that, God, even as we leave this place, you will continue to minister to us. You will speak to each one of us in the language that we will understand. And that even tonight, Lord, you will show us clearly the areas that are yet to be covered. Thank you for hearing us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.